Again, it's just set my people free.
Oh, let my people go. Okay.
Hello. So that's where we are. So I'm glad that you're able to join us and worship this evening. 19 become a part of our lives, we will be celebrating communion here in our worship space. What that means is that we have little individual cups that you will come in. As you come into the worship space, you will pick up your communion cup that has the wafer and juice together. And you will leave it in your pew, and then we'll all do communion at the same time. But for those of you who are joining us at home, you are invited to participate in communion at home alongside of us. So if you would like to receive the cups that we have so that you are partaking in the same elements that we are, I'm happy to drop those off at your house if you'd like to do that. But if not, in the Presbyterian tradition, any juice or bread cracker will do. So if you've got some grape juice or wine in hand, you are welcome to use that with a cracker. Whatever you have is meant to be, the way we do communion is it's common elements. So there's nothing more common than what is actually in your house. So if it's bread and water, that also works as a way to participate in communion together. So we're excited about that. If you have questions or you want the communion cups dropped off at your house, just let me know and call the office for speed. Also, next Sunday, we will do the blessing of the animals. So we're going to, every fall, we do a blessing of the pets or the animals. We're going to do it this year instead of here. We're going to go to the VFW Pavilion because it is sheltered and a place that we can all be better space. And judge our space better with our animals, because we know that not all animals play well together. So that will be great. So that will be at 3 p.m. next Sunday after worship. We'll do a blessing of the animals. So I hope that your critters bring you, I forget, the announcement's funny in the, and I don't remember the word either, it was funny. So animals and their, animals and their people are invited to the blessing of the animals. So that is all this week. For our prayer requests, this week we have Dennis Newell on our card shower. Dennis's health is not doing well. And I think he is such an important part of this community and has been an important part of a lot of our lives as we've lost loved ones. That now might be a really great time to express to Denny what he's meant to us over the years as he's worked at the funeral home. So if you'd like to send him cards, his address is in there. Also, I want to extend a personal thanks from my grandparents. Many of you sent them cards as they celebrated this weekend their 65th wedding anniversary. They were so tickled to have all these cards from strangers. Because I know they don't have a lot of friends left, right? So it's always exciting to have those moments in your life kind of recognized. So I give you thanks for your support of me through my grandparents. It was really great for them to experience some Decatur love. So thank you for that. Also, a note from Pat Covich, who also sends her thanks and gratitude for all the cards and things. And she's been recovering and still recovering. So we'll continue to keep Pat in our prayers as well. As Nancy, do you want to give an update on Nancy?
Sure. Nancy had surgery on the wrist on Friday, and it was successful. And she's still in a lot of pain, but she's going to be there. So she's got time to come back. She's going to be helping her surgery for her own surgery. I want to thank Cousin Marcia Gruber. First of all, she brought some pie.
We've got lots of Cousin Marcia.
And Cousin Marcia Sycamore brought some cookies. And Judy was gracious enough to bring some hospitality.
Oh, good.
So, and she's received very kind from the individual bodies and everything in that. And she's very appreciative of that and very well. One other thing, Linda is not with us today, obviously, but on Tuesday, her shipping name is Wayne.
Oh.
So, do we have her address?
We've got it in the directory. It should be in the directory.
In the directory?
Yeah, yeah. So Linda and Ron's anniversary is this week. Yeah, so let's make sure we also show them the card. Because apparently y'all are really good at that. So other prayer requests. more than what that looks like in the teen phase of their life. So we'll continue to pray for Karen. I also have a fun note that we received from Laura Servin. If you remember, Laura was with us. She put it in here, July 19th, 26th, and August 2nd. And she wrote us a lovely note. I will not read all, but I'll leave it out so you all can read it at your leisure. But she enjoyed participating along with Linda, and she appreciated being allowed to practice at the church. Having lived my adult life in the Northwest, I have come to appreciate more many things about Decatur and First Presbyterian. I experienced a sense of security, challenge, and validation, and I'm so grateful for the devotion and the faith shown by the people of the church. The roots of my faith stem from my many happy memories created at First Presbyterian Church. Yes, let's turn to God in these troubled times. God answers us for us. Which is a really little time sometimes, so we give thanks for that. Since Linda's not here, we do have special music, so thanks to Joel for adding his gift of music. Yes. Don't forget newsletters this week. If you have anything that you'd like to share with us, please let us know Monday, Tuesday, and then look in your mailboxes Wednesday. Any other joys, concerns, or announcements? Yes. I don't know, I guess. I didn't realize how many people got married in September. I thought.
It's also Lisa's birthday tomorrow.
Oh, that's right. We just told everyone how old your wife is. You are in the doghouse. Exact same day. All right, yes. Well, congratulations, Marcia, and Doug. Happy birthday, Lisa. So much to celebrate.
Since the theme of our scripture this morning is freedom, because we're going to start off with freedom, a song called Freedom. Freedom, oh, 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 freedom. Freedom, oh, 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 freedom. Freedom, oh, 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 freedom. Over me. And before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in the grave, and go home to my Lord, and be free. Freedom, oh, 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 freedom. Freedom, oh, 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 freedom. Freedom. Over me, and before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in the grave, and go home to my Lord, and be free. No more weeping, no more weeping, no. And before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in the grave, and go home to my Lord, and be free.
Good morning, everyone. Would you please follow along as I read the call to worship? In the beginning, before time, before people, before the world began, God was. Here and now, among us, beside us, clearer than air, closer than breathing, God is. In all that is to come, when we have turned to dust and human knowledge has not been completed, God will be. Not despairing of earth, but delighting in it. Not condemning the world, but redeeming it through Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. God was, God is, God will be.
Amid the countless things that human beings cannot fully comprehend about God, there stands this. God so loves us that we, washed by grace, fed by mercy, and our sins are forgiven. Confident in the love of God, let us pray together the prayer of confession. God of deliverance, we confess that we hear the cries of the oppressed, and our hearts are hardened. We do not want to change the systems that benefit us. We place blame upon others instead of examining our own flaws. We are stubborn and we selfishly cling to our own comfort. Open our hearts, O God, to the least of these. Help us to see what we cannot see. Forgive us and renew us to continue listening to your voice and the voice of your people. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. When we turn to God, the Lord freely pardons. We can trust that in God and not, we can trust in God and not be afraid. Friends, believe the good news. Through Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. I'd now like to invite Judy Kish up to do a minute for mission.
Peacemaking is active, not passive. Doing, not waiting. Let us think for a moment. Peacemaking is active, not passive. Doing, not waiting. And this is a season of peace when we, the church together, are focused on seeking peace and reconciliation. Together we are building God's house of peace, where we all are welcome, where all can find compassion, peace, and justice. We are the peacemakers. Here in our community, we are helping to support the Wings of God in Faubel, Michigan, a transition home for previously incarcerated women. Our hope is supported by your gift to the Peace and Global Witness offering. These gifts also unite us with Presbyterian peacemakers across the country and the world who are active, not passive, who are doing, not waiting. In Baltimore, Maryland, the Huntington Ridge Presbyterian Church use their share of offerings to promote anti-violence programs in their schools. Our gifts to the Peace and Global Witness offering have also been combined with others to help end the forced inscription of child soldiers, to end gender-based violence and violence against women. With our gifts, we are part of these efforts, whether they are regular behavior or places we've never seen and maybe never will. But these are all places that have one thing in common, the need for freedom and dignity that Christ wants for us all. Let us offer the peace of Christ at all times and all ways. We are the peacemakers. Give generously to this offering by sending your check written to First Presbyterian Church and a peace offering written in the memo line to Post Office Box 220, Decatur, Michigan. Thank you.
This song is called Mother of Child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child, a long way from home, a long way from home. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone, a long way from home, a long way from home. To believer, to believer, a long way from home, a long.
For our children's sermon today, it's going to require some participation from the audience. So as you came in, there may have been popsicle sticks in your pews.
Do you have a popsicle stick?
Okay. If there is one in your pew that is not being utilized, please make sure that someone finds it. I think I've placed them in places where I think people are going to be. I love it. So, we are going to tell the story of the 10 plagues of Egypt. This is not a scripture that we normally read, and it is four chapters of Exodus that I have tried to condense down into 5 minutes. So, we'll see if we do this. So, I will call out a number of a plague, and if that is the number corresponding to your stick, I need you to wave it so that everyone knows what that plague is, and it's a visual of that. And so make sure that you turn it so everyone can see it. All right. The first plague, blood. Is that number one? River, dead fish on it. Oh, yep, there's number one. All right. Moses came to Pharaoh and said, Moses came to Pharaoh. But Pharaoh said, our Pharaoh will be played by Jan Rader. Our Pharaoh said, no. So Moses and Aaron warned Pharaoh that God would punish them and his people. First, the waters in the land of Egypt were turned into blood. On the brink of the river, Aaron raised his staff, stuck it in the water, and converted the streams into blood. All the people of Egypt and the king himself saw this miracle. They saw the fish die, the blood flowed over the land, and they turned with disgust at the offensive smell of the river. So they couldn't drink the water of the Nile, and they tried to dig deep, and they still couldn't find fresh water. The fish died, and the rivers and the lakes smelled terrible. For a whole week, no one was able to drink. Yet Pharaoh would not give in. Moses again came to Pharaoh and said,
let my people go.
But Pharaoh said, no. So then it was the second plague. Frogs. Aaron stretched forth his hand over the waters of Egypt, and frogs swarmed forth. They covered every inch of land, and they entered the house and the bedrooms. Wherever an Egyptian turned, whatever they touched, they found the slimy bodies of frogs. The croaking filled the air night and day. Now Pharaoh became frightened, and he asked Moses and Aaron to go pray Then God ordered Aaron to strike the dust of the earth with his staff, and no sooner than he did that, all of Egypt was covered with gnats and mites that crawled from the dust to cover the land. Although Pharaoh's aides pointed out that this surely was God's punishment, Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he remained relentless in his determination to keep the Israel people in bondage. Moses came to Pharaoh once more and said,
"Let my people go."
But Pharaoh said, "No." Then it was the fourth plague, flies. Then flies swarmed Pharaoh's office, Pharaoh's officials, the Egyptians in their houses, and across the land. Pharaoh asked Moses to pray for him once more, and when Moses left to pray for Pharaoh, the flies went away, but Pharaoh's heart was hardened. Moses came to Pharaoh and said,
"Let thy people go."
But Pharaoh said, "No." The fifth plague, pestilence. Then God sent an illness that killed all the domestic animals of the Egyptians. How the people must have grieved when they saw their stately horses, the pride of Egypt, perish, when all the cattle of the field were stricken at the word of Moses. Yet Pharaoh still hardened his heart and would not let the Israelites go. Moses cried out once more to Pharaoh and said,
"Let my people go."
The Pharaoh said, "No." The sixth plague, boils. Then followed the sixth plague, which was so painful and horrible that it must have struck the people of Egypt in horror and agony. God commanded Moses to take soot from the furnaces, to sprinkle it towards heaven, throw it up in the air, and as Moses did so, boils burst forth upon every person and animal throughout the land of Egypt. And Moses returned once more to Pharaoh and said,
"Let my people go."
But Pharaoh still said, "No." Then it was the seventh plague, hail. Now Moses announced to Pharaoh that the hailstorm was of unprecedented violence, was to sweep across the land. No living thing, no tree, no herb was able to escape it. The only way to be safe was to be inside. So they gathered their animals in shelters, and those who did not believe that the hail would come lost everything. When Moses stretched out his staff, hail poured down with such violence, deafening thunder over the earth, lightning split open the heavens, and hail did its work of destruction. Then Pharaoh sent for Moses and acknowledged his sins. Pharaoh said, "I have sinned this time. The Lord is the righteous one, and I and my people are the guilty ones. Beg the Lord to let it be enough of God's thunder, and I will let my people go, and you shall not continue to stand." So Moses replied, the thunder ceased, there will be no more hail, in order that you, Pharaoh, know that the land is the Lord's. And it happened, as Moses had said, the storm ceased, but Pharaoh's heart remained hardened. And then Moses came back to Pharaoh. He said,
"Let my people go."
But Pharaoh again said, "No." The eighth plague, locusts. When Moses and Aaron told Pharaoh to let everyone go without exception, young and old, men and women, animals, the whole group of the Israelites, Pharaoh suggested that only maybe the men should go and then leave the women and children here, as well as all of their stuff should stay here in Egypt. But he was willing to let the men go. Moses and Aaron did not accept that offer. Pharaoh became very upset and angry and ordered them to leave the palace. As soon as Moses left the palace, he raised his arms towards heaven, and an east wind brought a swarm of locusts into Egypt, covering the sun, devouring every green thing that had escaped the hail of the previous plague. Again, Pharaoh sent for Moses and Aaron and implored had them to pray to God to stop the plague. Moses complied once more, and God sent a strong wind that drove the locusts into the sea. When relief came, Pharaoh obstinately returned to him, and he refuses to liberate the people of Israel. Moses once more asks Pharaoh to
let my people go.
But Pharaoh said no. For several days, Egypt was enveloped in a thick and impenetrable darkness. It extinguished all lights. There were no candles to be seen. It was complete and utter darkness day and night. The Egyptians were scared and remained glued to their places wherever they stood or sat. Once more, Moses came to Pharaoh and said,
let my people go.
The tenth plague. The death. Oh, and Moses and Pharaoh said no. And it was the tenth plague, the death of the firstborn. Then Moses told the Israelites to make a sacrifice of a lamb and take the blood of the lamb and smear it over the doorpost. Then God would pass over that house. Those who did not do as Moses had instructed were not saved and born. And the firstborn male in each house was killed. The firstborn in each of each animal was also killed. It was not until after the tenth plague that Pharaoh finally relented to let the Israelites go. Very good. Thank you for listening.
Would you please follow along as I read the prayer of illumination? Holy Spirit, as your word is read and preached, pass among your gathered people, opening minds to increase understanding, opening hearts to bind us together in your love. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Our scripture lesson today is Exodus chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. Warning of the final plague. The Lord said to Moses, I will bring one more plague upon Pharaoh and upon Egypt. Afterwards, he will let you go from here. Indeed, when he lets you go, he will drive you away. Tell the people that every man is to ask his neighbor, and every woman is to ask her neighbor for objects of silver and gold. The Lord gave the people favor in sight of the Egyptians. Moreover, Moses himself was a man of great importance in the land of Egypt, in the sight of Pharaoh's officials, and in the sight of the people. Moses said, thus says the Lord, about midnight I will go out through Egypt. Every firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die, from the firstborn Pharaoh who sits on the throne to the firstborn female slave who is behind the handmill, and all the firstborn of the livestock. Then there will be a loud cry throughout the whole land of Egypt, such as never been or will be ever again. But not a dog shall growl at any of the Israelites, not at the people, not at the animals, so that you may know that the Lord makes a distinction between Egypt and Israel. Then all these officials of yours shall come down to me and bow low to me, saying, leave us, you and all the people who follow you. After that, I will leave. And in hot anger, he left the Pharaoh. The Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh will not listen to you in order that my wonders may be multiplied in the land of Egypt. Moses and Aaron performed all these wonders before the Pharaoh. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he did not let the people of Israel go out of his land.
So last week we heard God call Moses to lead his people out of Egypt, and now we see the real obstacles that Moses is facing. Luckily, he has Aaron by his side. He's not alone. sense of the plagues and what God is doing. The God we see portrayed in many parts of the Old Testament is often like that. God destroys the earth with a flood when people are misbehaving. God can encourage wars, hold grudges, and smite people. Now, this is not for the faint of heart. And now we see God plaguing the Egyptian people with terrible things. While many of the plagues would be categorized as huge annoyances and disgusting, the blood river and the frogs and bugs and those sorts of things, many of them were actually devastating to the land and to animals. When the animals get sick and die in pestilence, that's an economic hit. It affects the food supply, people's livelihoods, their ability to feed themselves. Certainly God doesn't want the Egyptians to starve. It's not like they themselves are the ones responsible for the enslavement of the Israelites. It's not the Egyptians' hearts that are hardened. It's Pharaoh's responsibility, and it's Pharaoh who's keeping the Israelites captive. It's not the Egyptians. So why would God punish all of them? Now, some biblical scholars would say that plagues had to be big and affect everyone in order for Pharaoh to get the point. But 10 times? If I were God, I would attack Pharaoh specifically. I would go after the palace. I would fill the palace with flies and frogs and add boils to Pharaoh and no one else. I would make his life miserable. I wouldn't go after the Egyptians as a whole because it's Pharaoh who needs to be punished. But that is not what God does in the scripture. Because contrary to what I may want to believe, God doesn't think like I do. But that's ultimately the point of the story today. God is proving to Pharaoh that Pharaoh is not that God is the only God in town, the great I am. And while I feel like it's somewhat insufficient to say, it's also what we need to hear. We are not God. God doesn't do things that we think God should do, or do things the way we think God should do them. God is God. We are not. And while we cannot predict or control what God will or will not do, we can control how it affects us. Pharaoh was confronted by God's power time and time again, and yet he does not listen. He continued to think the plagues were magic tricks, and he played this game with Moses and Aaron of, okay, this time I'll let go, haha, jokes on you. Time and time again, Pharaoh's response to God was his heart was hardened. When that phrase is translated into English, it loses a little bit of its meaning. Some of the translations say that Pharaoh was stubborn instead of hard-hearted. The word that's translated as hardened actually means to grow firm, strong, or strengthen. So the hardening of Pharaoh's heart is accurate, but it's also strengthening Pharaoh's heart. Now, that is a bit of a brain buster. It really can cause a lot of hard thinking. Could Pharaoh's heart really be strengthened by the plagues? Or is it just being hardened? Now, I don't know for sure, but I imagine it could be a both-and kind of scenario. So what is it exactly that's happening with Pharaoh's heart? Of course, we're talking in a metaphorical sense. As far as we know, his arteries were not hardened. That is not a what we see. But time and time again, Pharaoh says no. Sometimes he says maybe, but then always says no. He simply does not want to let the Israelites out of Egypt. And it does sound like he's pretty stubborn. And maybe it was his resolve to keep going strong, to gain strength. He kept refusing, and the more Moses asked, the more Pharaoh would say no. I think Pharaoh just kept digging in his heels. The more miracles, the more plagues, the less he was willing to listen and be reasoned with. He was hard-hearted and pig-headed. Does that sound like anyone you know? I will not make eye contact. We have a lot of phrases colloquially that we use to describe people who can be pig-headed, stubborn, hard-hearted. But if we're honest with ourselves and with one another, we all get this way. We think we're right, and we refuse to accept anything to the contrary of what we think. No amount of logic or rationale will be applied to get us to change our mind. I think this is a lot of what plagues our country right now. I think there are so many issues where people have just dug in their heels that they're not willing to listen to what anyone else has to say. You're wrong, I'm right, and that's all we need to know. We don't even need to listen to what one another say. We've all grown hard-hearted in this way. We've lost the middle, the ability to listen to another person, to respect their point of view, even if we disagree with it or fail to understand it. We're quick to turn the channel or to assume that it's wrong without even listening to what it is that people are actually saying. We are more often Pharaoh than we are Moses. Our hearts are hard. We make choices that seem counterintuitive just so we can prove that we are right. Pharaoh is confronted with the truth time and time again that God is God and Pharaoh is not God. And yet he chose to believe whatever he wanted. And then he kind of like doubled down on that perspective time and again as Moses is coming to him saying, "Let my people go." He is not listening to whatever Moses and Aaron have to say. He wasn't interested in really reaching a compromise. Pharaoh knew the truth, contrary to what was happening around him. Now, Pharaoh did not believe that it was God who was bringing about these plagues. He didn't want to believe that. To the Egyptians, Pharaoh himself was a god. And Pharaoh had convinced himself and others that these acts of God were coincidental or it was just a bad storm when the hail came through. It was maybe even magic. But they would not see it as evidence of God and that God was more powerful than anything that Pharaoh could do. And if there was a God who was more powerful than Pharaoh, that God was not on Pharaoh's side, but that God is the God of the Israelites. And Pharaoh knew that accepting that would not end well for him. So this is a huge blow to Pharaoh's ego, to know that he is not, in fact, God. This is a truth he wants to know. He doesn't want to know. And I think it's why he digs in and gets so stubborn. He doesn't want to face the truth of what he is or what he is not. We are more often like Pharaoh than Moses. We fail to see the hard truths. We struggle to accept our own flaws or even see our own stubbornness. Each of us has a hard heart. A place where we are so uncomfortable with what might be true that our hearts become hardened. We dig in and we shut out any voice that brings that truth to life because we simply just can't hear it. So where have you dug in your heels and refused to hear the voices of others? How has your heart been hardened? We all have our blind spots, those places we cannot see where we're wrong. And what's important is not that we have those things, but it's how we respond to those things. Do you refuse to accept the possibility that you could ever be wrong? Or do you listen and ask questions and try to understand? My hope and my prayer is that we are able to examine our hard hearts, that we are able to listen to the perspective of others. For we do not know what comes next in our lives. We cannot know what God is doing in the world or why God is doing those things in the world. But we can remain open to one another, open to seeing the power of God made manifest in our lives. We cannot remain hard-hearted. We must stay open to where the Spirit of God is leading us. And to open our eyes to those miracles around us that we simply are refusing to see. May our hearts be softened by God's grace and open to many wonders of what God has done, what God is doing, and what God will continue to do. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Let's pray. God, we come before you knowing that our hearts can be hardened. We do not always want to hear the cries of injustice, the voices of others, or to even recognize our own stubbornness. Guide us, O God. Help us to change. To soften, to be more open to your people and to your voice in the world. God, we give thanks to the community that you have called us into being, this congregation that supports and uplifts one another when we are hurting in body, mind, or spirit. We continue to pray for those among us. We pray for Ms. Newell. We pray for Nancy as she heals from surgery. We pray for Karen McKay as she celebrated the anniversary of her belated husband. God, there are many among us who are in need of your love, your comfort, your freedom that we can only find in you. God, we give you thanks for the celebrations in our lives, for anniversaries and birthdays that remind us of the joy that you can bring us. Help us to embrace those moments, to see the freedoms that we do have, so that we may live full lives as we seek to follow your Son, our Savior. He taught us to say together when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We are so blessed with so many gifts. And if there's an envelope in your bulletin for the Peace and Global Witness offering, you are welcome to leave that at the offering plate on your way out along with your offering if you have not done so. Those of you joining us online, we invite you to mail in checks to PO Box 220, Decatur, Michigan. Or you may go online and give electronically by clicking learn. us now give thanks to God and dedicate the offerings that we have received. Let us pray. We are your servants, O God, for you have loosed all the bonds that held us captive. In freedom, we follow you. In gratitude, we praise you, celebrating that what you have done for us in Christ. We bring before you these tithes and offerings, asking you to add your blessing so that all that we have and all that we are may be used in blessing others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And now we send you forth out into the world as people freed by God, loved by God, knowing that the God who was, the God who is, and the God who forevermore shall be, will be with you now and forevermore. And all God's people said, Hallelujah.
Bye, guys.